All right. Hello, everyone. Good evening to all of you, the dignitaries present over here, and the august audience who has joined today's meeting to view this particular session. I welcome you all on behalf of Justice Birokesar Ray Memorial Committee. Today, that is 26 July, we are observing the 63rd death anniversary of Justice Birokesar Ray, the first Chief Justice of Orissa High Court, and the 73rd anniversary day of the foundation of Orissa High Court. So without any further ado, I would like to call Advocate Prabhu Prasanna Behra to introduce today's event and the venerated dignitaries to our viewers.
Thank you, Devasis. Good evening, one and all present here. I think this particular event did not be introduced to anybody in the country, especially the legal fraternity of our state. It is said that a great man's life is always celebrated. To celebrate the life of such a great person who is an undisputed leader of Orissa, especially for lawyers, a brilliant advocate, the first advocate general of Orissa, who has been elevated as the judge of Patna High Court in 1945, the first Chief Justice, the president of Orissa High Court Committee, appointed by Parala Khemendi Ministry in 1943, whose recommendation was very important in formation of Orissa High Court, and a man who has contribution in socio-economic, political, and literal world of the country. Secondly, this particular function is important because of the foundation day of Orissa High Court, which has given us recognition, life, livelihood, and many more. It is our moral and most important obligation to remember and celebrate this day. Today's function is also important that we are going to discuss on a very important topic, which is excessive judicial activism leads to judicial overreach. The citizen of this country, each and every citizen of this country, has ultimate faith on the courts and the judiciary. Among the three pillars of the democracy, the judiciary is considered as supreme. We all know about judicial supremacy. But I believe there is a thin line of dividing factor which divides judicial activism over judicial overreach. Ladies and gentlemen, probably we would not have such a panel where we have one of the most dynamic, popular, and a judge who is known as the pathfinder and the trend-setting judge, my Lord Honorable Justice Sanjeev Kumar Panigrahisar, who has joined us as the chief guest of the function. We have Honorable Advocate General of Orissa, one of the most dynamic leader, influencing and embracing, and one of the tallest personality of legal fraternity, Honorable Advocate General of Orissa, Sri Ashok Pareja, sir, and the leader of our bar, inspiration from each and every practicing advocate of Orissa, Sri Jagabandhu Sahu, sir, with us. Probably this is the best panel we could have, one from the bench, one from the state, and another, the leader of the bar. So with this, I introduce the event. I introduce the honorable dignitaries who have accepted our invitation and spared their valuable time, and welcome them from the bottom of our heart. And with the permission of the dignitaries and the chair, the president of this function, I would request the host, Mr. Panda, to move ahead with the agenda. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Prabhu sir. Now I would request the memorial committee to begin with the lighting of lamp.
Thank you.
Now I would request Mr. Kumar Jagannath to sing the welcome song.
Sabuta par samastam ko namaskar jai gurudev jai jagannath. सूरज तुम रातिर तारा तते न देखिले जीव जीवनी परा अरे कालिया देरे धरा रा 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 रु रु रा 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 रु रु रा 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 सुखर सपन तुम दुख पासरा तते चाही चाही अखिलु हरे भरा हरे कालिया देरे धरा रा 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 रु रु रा 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 रु रु रा 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 मोर आशार बाड़ी अंध लौड़ी तोरी पाई चली बाट मुठी पड़ी आणिलु जदि ए जाए टाणी आउ अल्प थरुटे आसी देरे देखा सरु गल्प कला माणिक रे मो सुनाटा परा झांझी पैसा के तुम मेघ सरा अरे कालिया देरे धरा रा 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 रु रु रा 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 रु रु रा 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 खरा एने छाई एने मेघा किए जाने केते बेले तो कई जोगा एठ नई एठ पानी तथा पीससा पानी रे मिसिनी बोली तुलसी बासा निश्वास को नहीं जमा विश्वास परा चांद दिशिला खरा अरे कड़िया देरे धरा रा 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 रु रु रा 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 रु रु रा 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 रु रु रा 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 रु रु रा रा रा
Thank you so much, Kumar Jagannath, for singing such a beautiful song and mesmerizing the august audience. Now I would like to call upon the secretary of the memorial committee, Advocate B.K. Ragda sir, for giving a formal welcome address to our honorable guest and this august audience. Sir, please.
Mannath Sri Jagannath, Madguru Sri Jagadguru, Madatma Sarvabhutatma, Tasmai Sri Gurave Namo, Jai Jagannath. Good evening to everybody. Today's president, Mr. Sanatan Das, Advocate of the High Court Barasan and Vice President of the Committee. My Lord Honorable Justice Sanjeev Kumar Panigrahi, the Chief Guest of the today's function. Mr. Ashok Kumar Parija, Senior Advocate and President of Odisha High Court Bar Association. Mr. Jagbandhu Sahu, Senior Advocate and President of Odisha High Court Bar Association. And my dear friend Lakshminarayan Patel, distinguished seniors, senior advocates, and members of the bar, family members of Justice Roy, media persons, ladies and gentlemen, Namaskar. Today is a great day for all of us because on 26 July 1948, Orissa High Court with Sri Birakishwar Rai as the Chief Justice and Sri B. Jagannath Das and Sri L. Panigrahi and R.L. Narsingham as Queen Judges was inaugurated by H.J. Kania, the then Chief Justice of the Federal Court of India. Justice Birakishwar Rai became its first Chief Justice. It is a coincidence that he was expired on 26 July 1958, exactly 10 years later. Justice Rai was born on 21st October 1891 in the village Bagalgad near my village in the district of Cuttack. He had a brilliant academic career. He was graduated from Ravenshah College and obtained law degree from Calcutta University Justice Rai made his mark early in the bar. He was the undisputed leader of the Orissa bar for more than 14 years. He was the president of Orissa High Court Committee, the committee recommended for separate High Court for Orissa. He became the first Advocate General of New Orissa in the year 1937, and he being first Odia, elevated to the bench of Patna High Court in the year 1945. As a judge of Patna High Court, he has left indelible impressions. He was the president of Orissa High Court Committee. On the demise of Justice Roy, the then Chief Justice R.L. Narsingham spoke that he took a decisive part in the forming of Orissa High Court and in bring it to existence on 26 July 1948. The member of Justice Roy, the memorial committee organizing every year the memorial meeting on the foundation day of Orissa High Court. When he became the judge of Patna High Court, different Bar Association of Orissa, including the Civil Court Bar Association of Cuttack, and all the bars organizing a welcome meeting, in the said welcome meeting, in order to give a reply, Justice Roy spoke few words on how a judge should be. And he said, a judge must be bold enough to take any decision whenever his conscience is satisfied as to his righteousness, irrespective of whosoever the party be, whether the cause is between the citizen and citizen, or between citizen and the crown state. He must not fear anybody, nor must be grateful to anybody is found. That is the bold way in which a judge should give his decisions. That was the Justice Birekeshwar Roy. On this auspicious day, I would like to welcome our chief guest of the meeting, my Lord Honorable Justice S.K. Panigrahi. My Lord Justice Panigrahi, after completing LLB from National Law School of India University, Bangalore, he enrolled with the Odisha State Bar Council in 2006. Honorable Justice Panigrahi was a practicing advocate of Supreme Court of India, Orissa High Court, Delhi High Court, and many other high courts in all branches of law. Honorable Justice Panigrahi was appointed as Judge of Orissa High Court on 10th February 2020. In this short span of time, my Lord Justice Panigrahi delivered many landmark judgments while sitting single, and in division bench. On behalf of the Memorial Committee, I welcome my Lord Justice Panigrahi. I would like to welcome our learned Advocate General, Sri Ashok Parija, sir. He is also one of the relation of Justice Roy. I would also thank learned Advocate General, who has been a constant source of support and help throughout the process. On his able guidance, we are all able to organize such type of functions. We hope that he will continue his support and guide us. And also in this meeting, I would like to welcome Bula Bhai P.K. Roy, popularly known as Bula Bhai, to this meeting also. And senior members, so many senior members joined with us. I am also welcome each and every person. I lastly, once again, I welcome each and every person. I also welcome our president of the High Court Bar Association, who is the leader of our Bar Association, Sri Jagabandhu Sahu, who is a very good human being and always he is encouraging us. Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Once again, welcome to everybody joining us in this virtual meeting. Thank you.
Thank you so much, B.K. Ragada sir, for the welcome address. Now I would request Mr. Jagabandhu Sahu sir, senior advocate and president of Orissa High Court Bar Association, to start with his speech. Sir, please.
Respected president of this function, Sri Sanatan Das, Honorable Sri Justice Sanjeev Kumar Panigrahi, the chief guest of this function, Sri Ashok Kumar Parija, senior advocate and learned advocate general and chairman of Orissa State Bar Council, Sri Bijay Kumar Ragad, secretary of Justice B.K. Roy Memorial Committee, organizers of Justice Birekeshwar Roy Memorial Committee, friends from our Orissa High Court Bar Association, and friends from other local bar associations, esteemed family members of late Justice Birekeshwar Roy, all the esteemed participants and viewers of this function, ladies and gentlemen, I am privileged to be a part of this function organized by Justice Birekeshwar Roy Memorial Committee in honor of Justice late Birekeshwar Roy and to commemorate the 63rd death anniversary of a great legend in the history of Odisha. In a bizarre synchronization, the death anniversary of late Justice B.K. Roy coincides with 10th anniversary of Odisha High Court Foundation Day. Today's occasion also coincides with Kargil Martyr Day. Justice Roy was the first Odia judge in Patna High Court before inception of Odisha High Court in the year 1948. He was the first Chief Justice of Odisha High Court and first Odia to be the incumbent of highest judiciary of our state. He was the president of Orissa High Court Committee appointed by Parliament Ministry in 1943. The committee recommended for separate High Court of Odisha. Therefore, Justice Ray, to my opinion, was the chief architect behind the creation of this great institution of our state, where today we pursue our legal profession. He was the first Advocate General of New Odisha in 1937, after Odisha was made a separate province in 1936. We cannot afford to forget that it is the High Court Bar Association Cuttack demanding a separate High Court for Odisha, and on 26 July 1938, a resolution was adopted, and on 11th February 1939, a resolution was moved in the Legislative Assembly requesting the government to constitute a committee to examine the question of establishing a separate High Court for Odisha. This exercise ultimately culminated in establishment of High Court in Odisha under Odisha High Court Amendment Order 1948 on 26 July 1948. Justice Birakeshwar Ray, shown as the Chief Justice along with three other puni judges, and the High Court was inaugurated by Justice H.J. Khanna Kenya, the then Chief Justice of the Federal Court of India. On this auspicious occasion, the topic chosen for discourse today is excessive judicial activism lead to judicial overreach. The expression judicial activism and judicial overreach has its dividing line, though many a times many perceive the two as synonymous. It is a common perception, which everyone understands, that judicial activism is a healthy judicial trend intended for the benefit of the litigant and society at large, whereas judicial overreach frustrates such objective. At the outset, judicial activism can be termed as the use of judicial power to articulate and enforce what is beneficial to the litigant and society. Subordinate courts are endowed with power under Section 151 of Civil Procedure Code. Article 215 similarly confers power over the High Court being court of record, which also enjoys under constitutional mandate power to punish for contempt. Power under Article 226 and 227 are plenary powers available to High Court. Similarly, power under Article 141 and 142 confers stintless power conferred upon the apex court under the Constitution to grant complete justice to litigants. Courts, in its endeavor, always articulate, keeping in mind its constitutional obligation to help secure justice to the litigants, and in the process, the course adopted to dispense with justice appear to be discernibly a bold view, which is commonly understood as judicial activism. There is a very thin line between judicial activism and judicial overreach. When judicial overreach crosses its stint and turns to judicial adventurism, it takes the form of judicial overreach. Judicial overreach is meant a phenomenon when the judiciary starts interfering with functioning of legislative or executive organs of the government, and this is considered undesirable and a threat for a sound and healthy democracy. There are many examples of judicial overreach, namely imposition of patriotism in National Anthems case in 2016 by Apex Court. Secondly, proactive censorship in case of Jali LLB 2 by Bombay High Court. Liquor ban case, Honorable Apex Court banning sale of liquor at retail outlets, hotels, restaurants, and bars which are within 500 meters of any national or state highway. Another example is Apex Court setting up Justice Lodha panel and Lodha committee reports recommendation aiming at making the reforms and changing the year-old elite formation of BCCI that ruled the Indian cricket of central and state levels. One more example can be cited here, that is cancellation of this telecom license and spectrum allocated to 8 companies in 2G case by the Supreme Court and directing the government to allocate only through auction route. Judicial overreach has certain disastrous consequences. It destroys the spirit of the Constitution as the democracy stands on the separation of powers between various organs. Judicial overreach has its inherent adversities. To elucidate a few, it creates a conflict between the legislative and judicial system, conveying a message to the people as the legislature's inaction. A second adversary, to my opinion, would be judicial activism helps in strengthening the faith of the people in judiciary, but the action of judicial overreach destroys such faith. Third, erosion of trust on judiciary by reason of its overreach will dilapidate the democratic setup of the nation. Lastly, judicial overreach disturbs the constitutional equilibrium among judiciary, executive, and legislature. When the judiciary appears, triggering a grave violation of the doctrine of separation of power, the term judicial overreach comes into play. It is commonly known as judicial adventurism. Justice Mathur and Justice Kaju opines, in the name of judicial activism, judges cannot cross their limits and try to take over functions which belong to another organ of the state. It further states, judges must know their limits and must not behave like emperors. Apex Court very recently observed that the High Court should not indiscriminately direct appearance of secretaries of the state government to appear in person in courts, since it affects functioning of the executive and as far as possible, the practice should be done away with. Judicial activism, on the other hand, is a judicial weapon to serve and protect the public interest and enhance public faith and trust on the justice dispensing system. The role of judiciary is laudable. When we look into the judgment in the case of Bandhua Mukti Morcha, Niraj Chaudhary, and People's Vision for Democratic Rights while interpreting constitutional provisions to protect the weaker sections of society from the threat of forced or bonded labor. The case of M.C. Mehta, Sheila Borse, Gaurav Jain, Lakshmikanta Pandey are landmark judgments in the field of child welfare and development, which are in line of international convention on the subject. The case of Visakha versus State of Rajasthan is a significant step where the court played the role of legislature to prevent sexual harassment of women in workplaces. However, it took legislature around 16 long years to formulate the Sexual Harassment of Women at Workplace Prevention, Prohibition and Redressal Act 2013 to save the plight of the victims. This may be an act of judicial overreach, but this is in essence judicial activism to address the sufferings of the women at workplace. Last but not least, judicial directions issued by judiciary in critical COVID situations in the country, both the apex court and various high courts in the country in all cases, to begin with, direction for assistance of migrant stranded laborers, regulating supply and distribution of COVID drugs, medicines, injections, rationalize and ensure equal distribution of COVID vaccinations, ensuring supply of oxygen cylinders. Here, judicial transgression into executive arena is considered to be divine act of judiciary. Therefore, judicial activism sans judicial overreach is a basic tenet of healthy justice delivery system. Separation of power under constitutional framework, often witnessed by invasion of one over the other in exercise of power available under their respective domain, which need to be harmonized only by self-restraint, mutual respect, and citizen-centric approach. The public discourse among the legal fraternity and members of civil society today, as this topic would be befitting homage to remember the great legendary personality of late Justice Veerakeshwara Rai on this anniversary. Thank you all.
Thank you so much, Jagabandhu Sahu sir, for so well deliberating upon judicial activism and judicial overreach. Now I would like to call, or rather I would say now I would like to request Learned Advocate General for the State of Odisha, Senior Advocate Mr. Ashok Kumar Parija sir, to give his deliberations on this topic.
Good evening, President of this meeting, Sri Sanatana Das, our Chief Guest, Honorable Justice Sanjeev Kumar Panigrahi, President of the Bar Association, Sri Jagabandhu Sahu, Mr. P.K. Rai Pullabhai, as is known to all of us, and I see a very important guest, Sri Vivek Patnaik, former Secretary of Government of India. Sir, we are honored and proud by your esteemed presence, Mr. B.K. Ragda, Lakshmi Narayan Patel, Prabhu Prasanna Behra, moderator Debasis Panda, all my friends in the bar. We have all assembled here to hear Justice Panigrahi speak, and I will therefore try and be as brief as I can. Late Justice B.K. Rai was an institution, a lawyer par excellence, a Chief Justice revered even today, and known around the country for his achievements, not only as a judge, but he was also visible in all walks of life. The journey did not end there. One of his sons, late S.K. Ray, became the Chief Justice of our High Court, and another son, B.K. Ray, became a judge of this court. This generation is represented by Shri P.K. Ray Bullabhai, one of the leading lawyers in the country. And at times I feel Odisha was not ready for him. We are indeed privileged and honored to have amongst us Justice Sanjeev Panigrahi to deliver this keynote address. I must congratulate Sanatana Babu and Ragda, my younger brother, who have selected a judge, academician, to deliver the keynote lecture. No praise will be enough for the efforts of Sanatana Babu and Ragda to continue celebrating this function year after year, year after year. And no amount of thanks is enough for them. Now a few words about the topic for discussion. Excessive judicial activism leads to judicial overreach. The topic is very relevant in today's India. In the words of Justice Bhagavati, the pioneer of social action litigation, to build a fair and just society, judicial activism on the part of the judiciary is an imperative, both for strengthening participatory democracy and for realization of human rights by a large number of people in the country. The function of a judge is not to merely declare the law as laid down by the legislature in a mechanical way. They must go beyond imitative reputations and reinvent existing laws with changing times and circumstances, to reinvent and adjust to new situations that might not have been anticipated by legislations. There are gaps between the generalities of law and specifics of life which can only be filled up by purposive interpretation by judges. Judicial activism is necessary because judges are entrusted by the Constitution to uphold fundamental rights of citizens by making the state accountable for violation of rights. Activism cannot be exercised either by directive principles of state. Policy holds social justice as a central feature and are fundamental for governance. Since they are not legally enforceable, they have to be preserved by the judiciary. Judges exercising activism have used broad interpretation to expand the meaning of Article 21 of the Constitution, expanding right to life and liberty to include fair and speedy trial, health, livelihood, shelter, food, education, and clean environment. Contrary to popular criticism, it is wrong to label judicial activism as judicial overreach or a manner of overstepping into the legislative domain. A court of justice cannot claim to be a court for the people if they cannot take steps to make basic human rights available to the citizens. Judges cannot act arbitrarily as they work within the constitutional framework and values. They are accountable because every judicial decision has to include the rationale behind it. Since they deal with public grievances on a day-to-day basis, the judges are more likely to be aware of the changing needs of society. thus to ensure political and social legitimacy of law, judicial activism is indispensable. I am reminded of the last big function we had at Cuttack, where Mr. Arun Jaitley had come to address the meeting. All of us were present, many of us were present there. And Chief Justice G.B. Patnaik said that when we have invited somebody like Mr. Jaitley, then why are we eating into his time by giving lecture? I am reminded of those words, and I apologize to our chief guest, Justice Sanjeev Kumar Panigrahi, who have eaten into his time as we have all come to hear him. With these words, I thank once again the Memorial Committee for having organized this function today. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ashok sir, for taking out time for today's session. We were really lucky and we are really obliged for hearing you, after hearing you. Now I would request my Lord Honorable Justice Sanjeev Kumar Panigrahi to give his views on today's topic. Sir, please. Sir, perhaps your mic is muted.
Now, I think I'm audible.
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Yeah. Namaskar, good evening, everybody. Respected chair of this session, our most revered Sri Ashok Parija sir, learned advocate general, Sri Jagabandhu Sahu, senior advocate and president, Orissa High Court Bar Association, Sri Bibek Patnaik, who is also present today, Sri P.K. Raya sir, Mr. Sanatan Das, B.K. Ragada, Alan Patel, all the office bearers of the B.K. Raya Memorial Committee, and Justice B.K. Raya's family members and all the participants of this webinar. I am overwhelmingly humbled and feel privileged to be part of this ceremony in the memory of Justice Birkishore Roy, who was the first Advocate General of the New Odisha Province, the great predecessors of the present AG Mr. Parija, and he was also the first Chief Justice of Odisha High Court. He died on July 26th, a decade later, on the 10th Foundation Day of Odisha High Court in 1958. So it's a coincidence that on the Foundation Day of the High Court, for which he fought very strongly to have a High Court in Odisha, and on the Foundation Day of that High Court, he passed away. The late Justice Ray led a distinguished legal career adorned with many firsts in his career. He was the first Advocate General of Odisha. He was the first Chief Justice of Odisha. Maybe many other firsts, I don't know. Our Advocate General and family members must be knowing that. I think somebody should take an initiative to write a book on Justice B.K. Ray. That will reveal many aspects of his life, which many of us don't know. Even I don't know many of the facets of his life. So in this context, I must request any of you who knows him very well, and maybe a group of people who knows him very well, and through his family members, and maybe sometimes it becomes folklore. When we talk about a great person again and again, it becomes a folklore. So from those folklores and from those ideas that have been spread across the bar members and the people around him who were there, so they must make an effort to write a book on him. This is the first request I must take, request I would like to make to the committee. Simply organizing a lecture is not sufficient. You must also make some research on him. What was the personality, what he was doing, what kind of person he was, what was his achievement, and various facets of his life. That could be a very good book. Unfortunately, nobody has tried yet. A lecture in his memory is therefore most befitting. both public and private. The late Justice Ray exemplified a disciplined life. His thirst for knowledge was unending, as indicated by his love for reading books and also his style of judgment writing. I had the occasion to read his few judgments, or else I didn't have any other material to read about him. So I may be excused if I have not shared sufficient light on this great personality, though many of you have done, but I think I am not doing justice to memorize this great personality because I don't know anything about that person much, except saying that he was the first Advocate General, he was the first Chief Justice of Odisha High Court, nothing else other than this part. I would draw to your attention the importance of command of language, the way he was writing. I had the occasion to read a few judgments written by him, especially to those students coming into the law. The art of persuasion in the courts in all places depends on the command of language, which is the vehicle of thought. Let me just remind you that Sir Winston Churchill said once, he said, by spending so long in the lowest form, I gained a great advantage over the cleverer boys, for I got into my bones the structure of the normal British sentence, which is the noble thing. So this is what the importance of language as reflected in its judgment writing. Just think of few sentences which have altered the history. I remember reading those words of Winston Churchill, where he says, we shall fight on the beaches, we shall fight on the landing grounds, we shall fight in the streets and in the fields, we shall fight in the hills, we shall never surrender. These are the powerful words. What is the power of the words which alter the course of history? And the late Justice Ray was trying to embolden that spirit of words and good language throughout his judgments. Let me also remind you, those who are in the law profession, that you must represent not only the popular cause, but also unpopular cause. That is what Justice Ray has reflected during his lifetime as a lawyer also. Lawyers have a monopoly of audience in the courts. No one can appear for a client except a qualified lawyer. Will forever and at all hazards uphold the dignity, independence, and integrity of the bar, and without which impartial justice, the most valued part of our constitution, can have no place at all. Such spirit will be the greatest tribute to this great soul, and I would once again request the memorial committee, please take step to write a book on him. Of course, the ceremony is bereft of any physical contacts or gesture, but it is being organized in an era of new techno-legal culture, when there is a constant struggle to bridge the digital divide, which is, of course, quite contemporaneous task during the pandemic. This forum has a good fortune of hearing the speeches of legal stalwarts and very distinguished speakers in the past. Today, in the presence of our extremely erudite guests spreading over different parts of the state, will definitely contribute immensely in making the next 2 hours engaging and fascinating. Foremost, I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me to deliver my address on a very befitting topic on this 63rd death anniversary, which also happened to be the foundation day of Orissa High Court. It is indeed an honor and privilege for me to be here this evening. Let me share my thought on today's topic, judicial activism. And I would shorten it, judicial activism versus judicial overreach. These two terms are very, I would say, relative term. We don't know where the judicial overreach, the activism finishes and overreach starts. Demarcating line, like McMahon line or this Radcliffe line. So there is no demarcating line. So this is there also, the demarcating line is very blurred. Here also this is very blurred. Ruler of England, Stuart King James I, on November 13, 1608, entered the royal courts and claimed that he could take any case he chose, remove it from the courts, and decided in his royal persons. Chief Justice Coke answered, that he could not do so, but the case ought to be determined and adjudged in a court of justice according to the law and custom of England. The king was greatly offended and replied, "This means that I shall be under law, which is treason to a firm." Coke replied, "The king should not be under men, but should be under God and law." Chief Justice Coke's reply was an affirmation of the judicial power while upholding the rule of law against arbitrary decisions of the sovereign. This was judicial activism at its finest, and it is the beginning. 1801, Chief Justice John Marshall highlighted and reaffirmed the power of American Supreme Court to invalidate congressional statute in the celebrated case of Marbury versus Madison. This is a famous case of 1803. He avoided a direct conflict with the administration while highlighting and reaffirming the judicial review power to invalidate an act of Congress. Chief Justice Earl Warren of the U.S. was one of the greatest activist judges who have profoundly influenced the Indian Supreme Court. Many of our Supreme Court judgments are quite influenced by his judgments. By his decisions, he legitimized affirmative action by the courts and removed racial discrimination in schools by desegregation, reapportion, obsolete electoral districts, and enhanced the right of poor accused and the defendants. This is how he played a very important role as an activist judge in USA. Judicial activism describes judicial ruling suspected of being based on personal or political considerations rather than on existing law. The question of judicial activism is closely related to constitutional interpretation, statutory construction, and separation of power. Black's Law Dictionary defines judicial activism as a philosophy of judicial decision making whereby judges allow their personal views about public policy, among other factors, to guide their decisions. Judicial activism means active role played by the judiciary in promoting justice. Judicial activism, to define broadly, is the assumption of an active role on the part of the judiciary. This is what the broad meaning of judicial activism, and to a layman, this is the meaning. Ronald Dworkin, a famous scholar, given an example. He rejects the strict interpretation of the constitutional text because it limits constitutional rights. Everything is not defined in the Constitution. Many things has to be interpreted by the courts. He says, to those recognized by a limited group of people at a fixed date of history, Constitution was examined, deliberated by a limited number of people at a fixed date of history. That is what he says. And many things, it changes. Like, it's organic. It keeps changing. So when there is changed situation, we need a law. Many things Constitution doesn't provide. So it is the judiciary that interprets the law and sometimes makes the law. But that is where the problem lies. So when the judiciary says something, you do this, you do that, and the government of the day has some problem with the judiciary, and then because always there is a loggerheads most of the time. And wherever there is a strong government at the center, or there is a generally judiciary is slightly, it has seen, I'm not saying that's weaker, but it is seen that judiciary is slightly weaker. Whereas there is a weaker government, judiciary becomes stronger. So in that way, this is seen, this is a theory, of course I say, it's not my view. Many scholars say that. According to Professor Upendra Bakshi, judicial activism is an inscriptive term. It means different things to different people. The proverbial elephant. What a person sees, somebody sees eyes. Different person see in a different way. So this is how this judicial activism, according to Professor Bakshi. While some may excel the term by describing it as a judicial creativity, Some people call it a judicial dynamism. Some of the judges bringing a revolution in the field of human rights and social welfare through enforcement of public duties. Others have criticized the term by describing this as judicial extremism. Some people call it judicial terrorism. Some people call it a transgression into the judicial activism, implies going beyond the normal constraint applied to the jurists and the constitution, which gives jurists the right to strike down any legislation or rule against the precedent if it goes against the constitution. Thus, ruling against majority opinion or judicial precedent is not necessarily judicial activism, unless it is active. In the words of Justice J.S. Verma, judicial activism must necessarily mean the active process of implementation of the rule of law, essential for the preservation of a functional democracy. In a modern democratic setup, judicial activism should be looked upon as a mechanism to curb legislative adventurism and executive tyranny by enforcing constitutional limits. That is, it is only when the legislature and the executive fail in their responsibility or try to avoid it that judicial activism has a role to play. In other words, judicial activism is to be viewed as a damage control exercise, in which sense it is only a temporary phase. If everything is going on fine, why should judiciary will play as an activist role? Because there is deficiency, because there's a deficit in different parts of the other parts of the governance, therefore judiciary come to play. And we call it judicial activism. Sometimes the political class call it judicial overreach. Recent times have seen judiciary play very intrusive roles in the areas of constitutionally reserved for the other branches of government. Issues in judicial activism arise when governance is apparently done by mandamus. I repeat, this is a mandamus-centric exercise. So then we call it judicial activism. Constitution of India operates in a happy harmony with the instrumentalities of the executive and the legislature. But to be truly great, the judiciary exercising democratic power must enjoy independence of higher order. But independence could become dangerous and undemocratic unless there is a constitutional discipline with rules of good conduct and accountability. Unfortunately, the accountability part is more with the executive than the judiciary. Without these, the robes may prove arrogant. We call people the judiciary as arrogant judiciary. Judicial activism is the view that Supreme Court and other judges can and should creatively reinterpret or interpret the text of the Constitution and laws in order to serve the judges' own visions regarding the needs of the contemporary society. Unfortunately, judges' own vision, that creates a problem. Whenever judges' vision is inserted into this thing, that becomes the center of the problem. So judge's vision should not be his own personal vision. It should be a constitutional vision. The constitutional vision will give true justice. Judicial activism believes that judges assume role as an independent policy maker or independent trustees on behalf of society that goes beyond their traditional role as interpreters of the constitution and law. The concept of judicial activism is the polar opposite to judicial restraint. There is judicial restraint versus judicial activism. Failure on the part of a legislative and executive wings of the government to provide good governance makes the judicial activism imperative. Delivering justice to a population over a billion does not sound like and never have been so easy to ask. It, however, becomes increasingly difficult in a country like India, where you have 1.25 or maybe 30 billion population. The executive, the legislature, and the judiciary are the three wings of the Indian democracy. judicial activism, however, came into its own only in the last couple of years. In his Dr. Zakir Hussain Memorial Lecture, former Chief Justice of India, A.M. Ahmadi, once said, in recent years, I quote, in the recent years, as the incumbents of parliament have become less representative of the will of the people, there has been a growing sense of public frustration with the democratic process. This is the reason why the Supreme Court had to expand its jurisdiction at times, issuing novel directions to the executive. So judicial activism might sound for a layman a heavy duty term, but in the simpler manner, it is quite easy to comprehend. We can say in simple words that judicial activism is a practice by the judges that does not involve balance of law. Instead, it hampers it. The judicial activism, the judge places his final decision with his heart and mind, which is emotionally handled. If emotion plays a very important role, then there is a problem. Then, of course, we are heading towards our reach. Therefore, I say there is a very delicate balance between these two terms, judicial activism and judicial outreach. If judge uses his own mind, own emotion, bereft of the constitutional values, constitutional ethos, and the dicta of the law, then it creates a problem. And very often, the judicial overreach, the so-called judicial overreach, is because of that. It at times works in favor of to save from the wrong decision to take place, but at times it also backfires on us. In other words, we can easily say that judicial activism is the practice going beyond the normal law for the jury. There are some very important cases which came in the talk whenever we discuss about judicial activism in India. I would just have a short snap of these phases. In the first phases, from 1950 to 67, I have just categorized this in certain phases. The first phases, the Supreme Court adopted the attitude of judicial restraint in which the court gave a strict and literal interpretation of the Constitution. Very strict. At that time, the judicial activism was very less. The first phase, 1950 to 67. The nature and scope of judicial review was first examined by this the Supreme Court in A.K. Gopalan case, where it accepted the principle that of judicial subordination to legislative wisdom. But on the whole, it limited itself and exercised judicial restraint. So that was the phase of judicial restraint, 1952-1967. There's a phase of judicial restraint. I would say it is during the first, after independence, after having the new constitution. I think this is precisely the Jawaharlal Nehru's terms, maximum term. So at that time, there was complete judicial restraint. There is no scope for this judicial activism. That doesn't mean that executive was fully well, the legislative wing was perfectly fine. Maybe there are some other reasons why this phase was a dormant phase of judicial activism, I would say. The second phase unfolded with the Golaknath case, which resulted in open conflict between the judiciary and legislature. The parliament asserted its supremacy, and Supreme Court asserted its power of judicial review, which resulted in a series of constitutional amendments in which parliament tried to limit the power of judicial review. In the emergency of 1975, between 1975-77, the judiciary was made subservient to the legislative and executive. That was the emergency phase. And you know how judiciary was made subservient by the then legislative wing. In Golaknath case, the Supreme Court gave an unprecedented judgment, which was clearly a case of judicial activism. The reason of imposing emergency was decision of Allahabad High Court setting aside the election of Prime Minister Indira Gandhi to the Lok Sabha. The 42nd Constitutional Amendment Act was also passed, which put new limitation on the judiciary. After the emergency, the 44th Constitutional Amendment Act was passed, which restored the judiciary's position as it had existed before the emergency. In Minerva Mill case, the Supreme Court declared judicial review as a part of basic structure of the Constitution. Since 1980s, we saw the emergence of judicial activism as a powerful tool in the Indian polity. Thus, now we find that the Supreme Court is no longer exercising judicial restraint. Now it is a complete, after 80, the judicial restraint phase is over. The judicial activism phase began. But in fact, it takes up judicial activism so much, a code giving new meaning to provision so as to suit the changing social and economic conditions or expanding the horizon of rights of the individual is said to be an activist code, thus has given birth to judicial activism. In the words are again, I quote Justice J.S. Barma, who says, the role of judiciary in interpreting existing laws according to the need of the time and filling in the gap appears to be the true meaning of judicial activism. In Minerva Mill versus Union of India, it has been stated that the Supreme Court overruled, in that case, the Supreme Court overruled that the amending power is a basic structure of the Constitution. By this time, the legislative and judiciary in India were at loggerheads. That was a very disturbing phase. There was a huge tension between the two wings. Then in Sunil Batra versus government of Delhi government, in this case, Supreme Court interpreted the writ of habeas corpus as not only producing a person in the court, but also preventing a person jailed from the inhuman treatment in the prison. This is a famous Sunil Batra case. Most of you have studied it. And again, in the MC Mehta versus state of Tamil Nadu, in this case, Supreme Court not only pronounced that deployment of children in hazardous factories is unlawful, but also provided various guidelines for the children's welfare. PIL jurisdiction began haltingly with a little idea of its potential in around 1979. So the PIL jurisdiction started taking shape, and the judicial activism started taking shape in the form of PIL jurisdiction. So in 1979, Supreme Court advocate Kapila Hingorani drew the court's attention to a series of articles in the newspaper exposing the plight of Bihar under trial prisoners, most of whom had served the pre-trial detention more than the period they had. So Sunil Batra was a prisoner who wrote a letter to Justice Krishna Iyer of the Supreme Court, drawing his attention to torture by prison authorities and the miserable condition of the prisoners in jail. This was taken up by the Supreme Court as a petition, and the court passed orders for human condition in jail. In 1980, two professors of law wrote a letter to the editor of a newspaper describing the barbaric condition of detention of the protective home for women in Agra, the exploitation of workmen at construction sites in violation of labor laws. All these issues have been brought to the Supreme Court, and Supreme Court play an important role as an activist court. The journalists moved the court against the eviction of pavement dwellers of Bombay. Several cases of this type followed. Here also, Supreme Court played a very important role as an activist role. Very recently, the Union government has filed a review petition in the Supreme Court against its order in Ram Jethmalani's case. You must have heard that, about the constitution of special investigating team to probe the black money. It is for the first time that the court has taken over investigation by appointing a former judge of the Supreme Court as the chairman of SIT and another former judge of same court as a vice chairman. Justice Prasad is the vice chairman in that committee. The Union government had appointed a high-level committee comprising Revenue Secretary, Deputy Governor of RBI, and so many other officials. And they have tried to find out what is the extent of black money that is parked outside. So, stashed outside, whatever you call it. So, this is how the Supreme Court, here the role has become a very, Supreme Court is playing a proactive role proactive judiciary. Here you can't say it's an overreach. Of course, the executive has failed. At some point of time, the executive has failed. Whenever there is a failure, or you can say, there seems to be the failure of the governance at the executive side, then the court's role become very imperative. In another case, in the Nandini Sundar versus Chhattisgarh, the apex court declared the appointment of special police officer SPO under the policy of arming the civilian vigilant group, what we call the Salba Jadum. In both the cases, the court has lambasted the neoliberal economic policy of the government and held it responsible for the growth of black money and, of course, this kind of inequality in the nationalism area. In both the cases cite, the Supreme Court has become very, very critical of this system. Both the judgments are replete with condemnation of the state's immoral and economic policy in florid language. The question, are judges competent to do so? That's the basic question that arises. Can the judges of Supreme Court do that? Motilal Sathyalal lecture, Justice Kapadia once said, he tried to diagnose the disease properly and cautioned his colleague against breaching the doctrine of separation of power. We do not have the competence to make policy choices, he says, I'm quoting, we do not have the competence to make policy choices and run the administration under the doctrine of separation of power. Each of the above organs must stay within the powers allocated by the Constitution. Justice Kapadia has rightly raised the issue of accountability. The elected representatives are more accountable to the people. The executive organ of the government is more accountable to the people. But judiciary is slightly, I think, less accountable. But in other words, when we are making a law, when we are trying to interpret law something wrongly, so we are not accountable to anybody. So that's why we have to, that Lakshman Rekha should not be crossed. There is always a Lakshman Rekha. If one examines all these cases, it is pretty clear that judicial activism is against the legislative hegemony. But the question may arise, is it against democracy? Legislative is a democratic body. It gains the authority from the people directly. On the other hand, judiciary has no popular mandate to back it. It is an independent authority. So by principle, judiciary ratifying the legislature is against the principle of democracy. But the constitutional scheme provides and it gives the power to judiciary to review the law through the power of judicial review. And that is also a very integral part of the Constitution and what we call the so-called basic structure. Actually, there is no such basic structure in the Constitution book, but by judge-made law, the basic structure doctrine has been, borrowed. But arriving any such, by principle of judiciary ratifying the legislature against the principle of democracy, but arriving any such conclusion is not an easy task. There are many loopholes in such straightforward criticism. Suppose the legislature makes the law which affects the liberty of the people and which is a gross violation of human rights. In this case, does the judiciary remain silent and follow the rule of law principle, even if the law is inhuman? That's the question. There we have to answer. There the judiciary plays an important role. And people criticize the judiciary, say this is judicial overreach. This is a question which has far-reaching significance. There is no absolute solution to this. To analyze this, one needs to reinterpret and interpret the word democracy itself. In America, judges are chosen on ideological grounds by the presidents who are grilled by the Senate live on the television. Thus, people know the ideological commitment of the person going to be appointed as judge of the Supreme Court. Still, they tenaciously stick to the Constitution, even if they are appointed by political parties. What we call the their appointment system very in other jurisdiction, it's called a very flawed system. But they, when once they become judge, they stick to the constitution. In India, judges are apolitical and they have to interpret law strictly within the mandate of the constitution. In the Black Money Order, the court has clearly overstepped on the ground of protecting the fundamental right of equality and the right to life and personal liberty. Laws, so this is what the criticism is. Laws' ends are long, and some kind of amorphous connection can always be established with the right to justify judicial intervention. Judicial activism earned a human face in India by liberalizing access to justice and giving relief to the disadvantaged groups and have-nots under the leadership of Justice V.R. Krishnayar and P.N. Bhagwati. The PIL doctrine was for the first time it was introduced. The PIL, the concept of PIL, is covering a wide spectrum of issues have been solved through this PIL. Road safety, whether it is road safety, pollution, illegal structure in VIP zones, monkey menace, dog menace, unpaid dues by farmers, unpaid dues to the farmers, nursery admission, what not. So many issues are coming under the PIL. So this is how PIL jurisdiction is called, this is mostly the judge act as an activist. The two most prominent figure in the Bar Council of India, whose names are most interrelated with judicial activism, are Justice P.N. Bhagwati and Justice V.R. Krishnayar. The Golaknath case, So the Golaknath case is an example of judicial activism. The Supreme Court, by a majority of 6-5, laid down that fundamental rights as enshrined in Part 3 of the Constitution are immutable and beyond the reach of any amendment process. The power of Parliament to amend any provision in Part 3 of the Constitution was taken away. In Keshavanand Bharati case, by a majority of 7-6, the Supreme Court held that Article 368 of the Constitution, Parliament has the amending powers, but the amending powers does not extend to alter the basic structure doctrine was inducted in that. So we borrowed the basic structure doctrine. I don't know where from we have borrowed, I have to check. I don't remember. The basic structure of the Constitution being supremacy of the Constitution, republican and democratic form of government, secularism, separation of power and between the legislature, executive and the judiciary, then federal character of the Constitution. These are called the basic structure doctrine. This is basically is a Keshavanand Bharati induced basic structure doctrine. Supremacy and permanency of the Constitution have thus been ensured by the pronouncement of the summit court, the Supreme Court of this country, or what we call the apex court of this country. And after making these observations, certain reasons can be generalized from this discussion. We can say the following are some of the few points which I would like to say, that judicial function assigned to the Constitution is part of the organic structure of law. And while interpreting the Constitution, while taking care of the welfare of the people, taking care of protection of the rights of the people, the judiciary has to play a vital role. Whenever there is a situation like near collapse of responsible government, wherever there is pressure on the judiciary from other sources, but there should not be so much judicial enthusiasm. I would use the word judicial enthusiasm. Unless there is a very, very important issue has come before the judiciary, judiciary should have some restraint. Excess enthusiasm on the part of the judges is likely to be branded as judicial overreach. Whenever there is a legislative vacuum there, then judiciary can step in. Like in Visakha case, there was a legislative vacuum. So through judiciary passed certain guidelines, and then this act was enacted later. Whenever there is a breakdown of the constitution, judiciary has to play a very important role. Whenever the validity of law is in question, then judiciary has to play a very important role. Because the Supreme Court, the constitutional courts are the guardian of the constitution. They have to guard it. Wherever there is a, so if you have excessive activism, or I would say judicial enthusiasm is more, in that case, the public confidence in judiciary will be less. And we'll be criticized as judicial, our act as judicial overreach. So, in this way, since 80s, the judiciary has played a very, very important role, an activist role, though very often at different phases. Judiciary has been criticized as it is judicial overreach, but many occasions, I would say, had there been no intervention by the judiciary, things would have gone haywire. So, especially in case of environmental, in case of intervention by the Supreme Court in environmental cases. So these things we must, that part also we have to see before just branding the Supreme Court as, I mean, you can say, an agent of judicial overreach. It is, that's why Justice Hidayatullah once said, the first principle to observe is that wisdom of the law must be accepted. A little incursion into law making, that will create a problem. In the 2G case, that all public resources and assets are a matter of public trust, and they can all be disposed of by in a transparent manner by the public action. Is it judicial activism? Is it judicial overreach? Of course, the government has its full autonomy to sell, I mean, to auction its resources, no problem. But whenever there is a complaint that the resources allocation is not proper, it is not followed in a proper manner, the government has, the Supreme Court has to play, and the judiciary has to play a role. There you can't say it's overreach. So in that way, so the, in fact, the answer often given by the judiciary to all kinds of problem, therefore we cannot call it overreach. Yes, whenever there is excessive judicial enthusiasm, the overreach takes place, and whenever there is overreach, there is a problem. So judicial activism is totally cannot be banned, cannot be stopped. It is obvious that under a constitution, a fundamental feature of which is the rule of law, there cannot be any restraint upon judicial activism in matters in which the legality of the executive orders and administrative actions are in question. The courts are the only forum for those wronged by the administrative excesses and executive arbitrariness. And there is no hope for the common man. Where will the common man go? It has to come to the court, and court has to interpret the law. Of course, excessive enthusiasm by the judges is always counterproductive. Thank you. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak on this great topic. Though it's a very, I have taken so much of your time. I'm so sorry. I think transgressed the time limit. I'm extremely apologetic for that. Thank you. Thank you so much.
It's a brilliant speech on activism.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir, for highlighting various important pointers relating to judicial activism and judicial overreach. Thank you very, very much for that. Now I would like to request the president of today's meeting, Advocate Sanatan Das, to speak few words. Sir, please. Sir, your mic is perhaps muted.
Unmute karantu. Sanatan Babu, unmute karantu. Unmute karantu. Come on, I check by Jochen. Again, unmute karantu. Upon Kothaki Sugunai. Upon Kothaki Sugunai, switch at the marantu. Unmute karantu.
Unmute karantu. न्यायमूर्ति श्रीजुक्त पाणिग्राही महाशय ओडिशा
पुणी हाथ मारले
बार एसोसिएशन अध्यक्ष श्रीजुक्त साहू एवं सभारे छाया सभारे उपस्थित थिबा समस्त सुधिजन मानंकु मो बंधु मानंकु मो अनुष्ठान तरफ साधुवाद जनाउछि धन्यवाद जनाउछि आपण मान समय नष्ट करि बा सब ई सुजोग रे आमको देइछन्ती आज जस्टिस रेंक कथा मन पकेया पई जणे भल लोकंक कथा मन पडिबा यहा एक सौभाग्य मो आजिकार प्रसंग उपरे किछि न कहि खाली एई धाडीटि कहिबि जणे साधु लोक जणे भल लोक उनकु मन पकेबा तांकर छाया पट बा पटचित्र दर्शन करिबा एहा भाग्यर कथा एहा पुराण वर्णित आपण माने समस्ते जानिछन्ति एहा भागवतरे भी मध्य अछि देखि सरला परे मने पकेई सरला परे बहुत पुण्य अर्जन करू जहा आमर ए जो स्मृति संसद तरफ रु श्रीजुक्त रायंक परिवार विषय रे जतिकि संग्रह करिछु तादर गोटे धाड़ी कहिबी खंडपड़ा राजपरिवार रो श्रीजुक्त दीनबंधु राउतराय पटनायक बड़ अंशीदार थिले कौनसी मते मनोमालिन्य घटी कटक आसी बगलगड़ पाखरे बहु कथा सब सुना जाए बगलगड़ पाखरे से निजे बसती स्थापन कले तीन पुअर राधेश्याम घनश्याम श्रीकृष्ण राधेश्याम एवं लतिका सॉरी सुमित्रा देवी औरसरु आमर महामान्य जस्टिस रॉय जन्मग्रहण करथिले सेतेबेलर भौगोलिक परिस्थिति सेतेबेलर आर्थिक परिस्थिति जो प्रकार थिला आम मानक चिंता करिवा बड़ कष्ट हुए जहा ओडिशा सरकार को बजेट नोटिफिकेशन जना पड़े आज्ञा 1947 मसीहार ओडिशा सरकार को बजेट थिला 9,77,00,000 1948 मसीहार बजेट थिला 11,26,00,000 मात्र भौगोलिक परिस्थिति चिंता करिबा भी बड़ मुश्किल जहा को नहीं कमिटी चर्चा करी रिपोर्ट दे थे प्रथम रिपोर्ट बोध हुए 1937 मसीहा जुलाई 26 तारीख द्वितीय रिपोर्ट 1943 मसीहा जुलाई 26 तारीख विधि विड़म्बना जुलाई 26 आम मानी एक शुभ दिन हो जाद जो रिपोर्ट दे थे कारण भौगोलिक परिस्थिति जातायातर सुविधा ना आम भितर बहुत लोक जन्म भी हो नथिबे जे कटक भुवनेश्वर छाड़ू काठजोड़ी पोल भी सठिक भाव हो न था तेणु गमनागमन सुविधा ना सब आमर जेकोसी गड़जात राज्य सठिक भाव सहयोग कर मिशी ना सिंहभूम सड़ई कला खरसुआई आंदोलन चली समय रे पटना रु ओडिशा हाईकोर्ट आसवा पारला महाराजा आमर गजपति कृष्णचंद्र नारायण देव हलिकोट महाराजा रामचंद्र मद्दराज एम सहायत जस्टिस राय जो एडवोकेट जनरल थे पूर्णांग रिपोर्ट 1943 मसीह उपस्थापन कले से सब कथा विशद भाव उल्लेख कर प्रत्येक जिनस को गोटी 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 करी से तर्जमा करी तार उत्तर दे जहाँफल कि निजर अनुभव सेतबर अध्यवसाय फल आज आम निजे ओडिशा हाईकोर्ट पाइ 1948 मसीह जुलाई 26 तारीख दिन से तो पूर्ववर्ती वक्ता माने कहि सलेनि अनकंटेस्टेड पार्लियामेंट मेंबर थिले उत्कल साहित्य समाज रो अध्यक्ष थिले बहु कथा बहु बड़ बड़ जगह रे थिले किंतु एते समय दे एते कथा मध्य रे एते डाइट शेड्यूल मध्य रे से ए रिपोर्ट उपस्थापन करथिले तेनु मु वर्तमान संसद तरफ रु आमर ए स्मृति संसद तरफ रु आपण मानकु समस्तंकु आउ थरे धन्यवाद दउची मु विदाय नेवा पूर्व रु आमर ए जो संसद को जो माने सब प्रकृत रे एर पृष्ठपोषकता रे सहाय्य करचंदी सुप्रीम कोर्ट रा प्राक्तन चीफ जस्टिस जस्टिस जीबी पटनायक मनोरंजन श्री मनोरंजन महांती आमर जे कैट रो उपाध्यक्ष थिले एवं आउरी बहुत सदस्य सब जो माने भी एको पृष्ठपोषकता रे सहाय्य करचंदी आम सहित उपस्थित अच्छा कि नहीं मुझे जानी नहीं मु समस्त को संसद तरफ रु धन्यवाद दौची एवं मु आशा करे आपण मान समस्ते ए जो अमूल्य समय नष्ट करी एथरे उपस्थित रही चंदी आउ थरे धन्यवाद आर नमस्ते
विवेक भाई उपस्थित अछंती विवेक पटनायक हमर पब्लिक सर्विस कमिशन रा पास चेयरमैन से मध्य उपस्थित अछंती
धन्यवाद सनातन सर आपणकर एड्रेस पई नाउ बिफोर एंडिंग दिस एनलाइटनिंग मीटिंग आई वुड लाइक टू इनवाइट मिस्टर लक्ष्मी नारायण पटेल हु इज द ट्रेजरर ऑफ मेमोरियल कमिटी टू प्रपोज अ वोट ऑफ थैंक्स सर
जय जगन्नाथ गुड इवनिंग टू ऑल माय लॉर्ड जस्टिस संजीव कुमार पाणिग्रही टुडे चीफ गेस्ट ऑफ द मीटिंग ऑनरेबल श्री अशोक कुमार परिजा लर्निंग एडवोकेट जनरल ऑफ ओडिशा श्री जगबंधु साहू सीनियर एडवोकेट प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ द ओडिशा हाईकोर्ट बार एसोसिएशन टुडे प्रेसिडेंट मिस्टर सनातन दास वाइस प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ द मेमोरियल कमिटी मिस्टर विजय कुमार माय फ्रेंड सेक्रेटरी ऑफ द मेमोरियल कमिटी आई एंड ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ द वीके राय मेमोरियल कमिटी मेनी मेनी थैंक टू माय लॉर्ड जस्टिस संजीव कुमार पाणिग्रही श्री अशोक कुमार परिजा सर एडवोकेट जनरल ऑफ द उड़ीसा श्री जगबंधु साहू सर दिस प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ द उड़ीसा हाईकोर्ट बार एसोसिएशन गेस्ट एंड फैमिली मेंबर्स ऑफ द जस्टिस राय विवेक पटनायक सर पार्टिसिपेंट स्टूडेंट मनोरंजन सर एंड मीडिया रियली आई लर्न लॉट फ्रॉम आवर चीफ गेस्ट एंड गेस्ट ऑफ ऑनर ऑन द टॉपिक एक्सेसिव जुडिशियल एक्टिविज्म लीड्स टू जुडिशियल ओवररीच आई वुड like to thank that you share your knowledge and experience and again I thank to all and also thank to Prabhu and Devasi thank you to all namaskar jai jagannath
jai jagannath ragadwa ko dhanyawad dale nahi
namaskar jai jagannath